Hello, 80s fans. Welcome to Passion 80s interview with Terri Nunn, lead singer of Berlin. Let's take you back to the 80s with your hosts, DJ Passion and co-host Sandro.
Okay, so Berlin are one of the most iconic new wave American acts to emerge during the 1980s. So first of all, it's great to have you back in Australia in 2023. The last time you toured Australia was in 2016 as part of the Totally 80s tour, which had Men Without Hats, Katrina and the Waves, Stacey Q, Lamal, our very own Wah Wah Nee, Martika. What are your memories of that tour?
I love Australia. I just love, I think you guys have the best accent in the world, and your attitude, and you're just very light and happy, and it's a wonderful environment. And so getting to go and have a little bit of extra time was fantastic. We don't always do that when we do a tour. They kind of pack, you know, because time is money and you're paying for every day you're out there. There isn't a lot of time to see anything when we go touring. And this last 2016 tour, we actually had a little bit of time in there to enjoy it, you know, to see you guys and hang out and have great Asian food. You have the best Asian food, dude.
Okay, really?
I'm a ramen freak, and ramen is plentiful there, and it's authentic, and it's yummy. I love ramen in Australia. So we did a lot of that. We did a lot of looking for that food. And just, you know, enjoying your country. I loved it so much that I brought my husband, because he's never been there. So in 2018, I brought him back to Melbourne and to Sydney, and he fell in love with it too.
Well, that was going to be my next question, Terri. Because I follow you on Instagram, I noticed that you put up a post that you were back in Melbourne. So that was a family holiday, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
We could have shown you the sights, Terri. So next time you come down, we've got to show you the sights.
Yeah, now I know you. Fantastic.
For sure.
Oh, that's fantastic. So Berlin have released 9 studio albums, correct me if I'm wrong, and 2 of them include the seminal Pleasure Victim and Love Life. In 2016, you reconnected with the original members John Crawford and David Diamond. And so I was curious, what's it like being recording and touring with them again?
It feels full circle for me. You know, we started the band. We're celebrating our 45th anniversary this year. John started it in 1977, and I joined in 1979. And then, you know, after, 10 years of doing it together, then we imploded, and then I reinstated it, but they were not in the band. John was married, he was with a very religious wife, and she was not okay with him making music. So it was without both of them. And then, as you said, in 2016, he was getting a divorce. And I had been through a divorce, so he called me, and, you know, we just kind of held on to each other through it, because it's hard. And then we started making music, and Transcendence happened, the album, and we got another record deal, and then, you know, he was back in the band. And it feels full circle, because 45 years, I don't know how much longer this band's gonna go. It's just so amazing that the original three are back in the band again now.
Right.
You know, like starting and finishing it together.
Yeah, fairy tales don't often happen in music. You read so many stories of, you know, original bands breaking up and the bitterness and enmity between the band members. And so it's kind of serendipitous, and that's why I was curious to understand, like, now that you're back together and recording again, you know, is the creative process different? Are you more forgiving? All those kind of things.
Both. The creative process is different, because one of the things I love about getting older is not freaking out all the time and not being as scared as I used to be. In my 20s, I was scared a lot, you know, of not being good enough, of being a fraud. You know, people would see that I didn't really have what it takes, and I was afraid of people and just all kinds of shit going on. So, you know, now it's so nice to realize that things work out and the universe is benevolent, and it's, you know, it just changes things. So
can I just say, you look fabulous for your age. And I know we're going off track a little bit here, but you certainly would know. You said 40-odd 5 years. I'm thinking you just made me feel so much older. And knowing that you've been on the road, I'm thinking, my godfather. But you look fabulous for your age. I would never have picked it in a million years. So congratulations on that front.
So yeah, thank you. It's also great now to be able to talk about, you know, the shit we were going through back then. Was, you know, like, we couldn't talk about it. You know, John was scared of losing his band, you know, when Giorgio Moroder came in with this song, and it's our number one song now, and it's not John's. And he was like, you know, it's not my band anymore, and I don't know how to write a great song, and I can't do this. But he couldn't share that with me then. He was just mad all the time. And now we can say, you know, this, I was afraid. I had all these fears going on, and of course he did. You know, it makes so much sense now to hear, you know, all of the different things that were going on with us back then that we can now share.
Yeah. Well, you know? I think it's really wonderful that us Berlin fans now get to experience the Berlin experience with both yourself, John, and David. So I'm really looking forward to that in Australia. You mentioned Transcendence, and I've listened to that album. I do, and it's a great album, but I do have one question. What was the thinking behind putting a updated version of Sexheimer on that album?
There was a remix that was done that we fell in love with, so we decided to put vocals on it. I just loved what it was, a kind of an updated musically, the dance kind of thing of it, and I was like, this is really cool, and I wanted to. So we just thought, all right, well, let's just do it again. So we stuck our vocals on top of the new remix version and put it on the record.
Okay. Now, in this conversation so far, we've mentioned two things I did want to ask you about. So firstly, you know, obviously the most iconic hit that Berlin has is Take My Breath Away. And everywhere you go in Australia, I'm sure just like everywhere else in the world, you go into the supermarket, you'll hear it. You put on classic hits radio, you'll hear it. It's just iconic and it's everywhere. Now, it's obviously different to all the early Berlin stuff. So I wanted your take on this, about your relationship with that song and how you think about it today. And the reason why I ask, if you indulge me for like 30 seconds, is someone like Jim Kerr, the lead singer of Simple Minds, when he's asked about Don't You Forget About Me, he kind of has this ambivalent attitude. Yeah, it's our greatest hits. You know, it's popular everywhere. It's played all over YouTube. It's all over Spotify. But he doesn't really seem to embrace that song or love it. So with that in mind, I was just kind of curious, what's your attitude to Take My Breath Away in 2022?
For me, it's a gift that keeps on giving. It's a phenomenon that I don't understand. I don't understand why any of the songs we've had as hits were hits. I love all the songs we put out, and so I have no idea which ones are going to affect people. And Take My Breath Away, it just keeps affecting people. It just keeps going. Mm-hmm. You know, like it's a juxtaposition of so many different elements that don't make sense together, but just work really well, and you can't make something like that happen. It just does, you know. So I'm in awe of it. I loved working with Giorgio. I did not have the problem that John did, probably because I wasn't the main songwriter of the band, so I wasn't saddled with the job of making hits for the record label and doing songs that the band liked and doing music that the public would like. I mean, he was so stressed about all of that, and I wasn't. I was excited to work with Giorgio Moroder. I mean, my God, he had worked with David Bowie and Blondie and Fame and Flashdance and Cat People. Cat People was incredible. It was, you know, so getting a chance to do anything with him was so huge. And so when I hear that song, it just reminds me of that I got to do that with Giorgio. You know, we're still friends. He says I'm amazed at this. He says that of all of the stuff he's done, all that stuff I just said, and more, Take My Breath Away, he thinks is his best work.
Wow, that's a big comment. He's got a lot of great material.
I know.
Oh my God.
Yeah, I mean, and then getting to sing it and like watch people, you know, I sing it and I look out and people go into a zone. They go into, I just watch, they like, where they were when they heard it, their first kiss and their first fuck and their first baby and when they graduated from somewhere and they played it. And you know, it's like everybody has their thing about that song. And I understand that because our music, it's like, it's our DNA. It becomes part of our bodies. Okay. It's like when a song comes on, we remember everything. We remember where we were, what we were smelling, what we were eating, who we were having sex with, what was happening, how we felt. It's all there, you know, because that song is in there. It's in, like, literally in our DNA, I think.
100%. Yeah, I love the passion, by the way, Terri. Love that passion.
Yeah, no, that's fantastic. I was going to ask you about working with Giorgio Moroder, but you've kind of answered that. And that's a pretty great compliment to have, going to bed at night thinking Giorgio Moroder thinks I'm one of the best people he's ever worked with. That's reassuring. And yeah, it must feel great.
And you know, the first time I met him, do you know what it was like the very first time? I'll tell you.
Tell us.
Okay. I wasn't a singer yet. I did a movie. I was a little actress. So I was like 18 and this movie was terrible. It was a disco movie called Thank God It's Friday. And it was basically like this, a way for Neil Bogart of Casablanca to showcase his musical artists. And the two main ones in the movie were Donna Summer and the Commodores. Well, guess who was on the set with Donna Summer, because he produced her and wrote, you know, the songs with her, Giorgio Moroder. Mm-hmm. And I'm just this little like 18-year-old like actor, right? And I'm like, that's Giorgio Moroder. And I went over to him and I'm so excited. I mean, Donna Summer, like, I just couldn't believe that her and everything. And I meet him and I'm like, hi, I'm Terri Nunn. And he's like, yeah, whatever. Nice. Yeah, whatever. And he just like couldn't give a shit, right? And who would have thought that 4 years later, whatever it was, 4 or 5 years later, we had an Academy Award together. You know, I mean, I didn't see it coming. He didn't. Nobody saw it coming. It's just so funny that he dismissed me. Just like, who cares?
Yeah, it could have been one of his many pleasants he would have met over the years.
You're still in contact with Giorgio occasionally?
We're still very good friends. He's a wonderful man. He's in his 80s now.
Yeah. Well, he's obviously good genes, or he looks after himself.
Yeah.
I mean, John gave you a compliment about how you look, which is obviously fantastic. But one question I had is, I mean, I've had the lucky thing where I've been able to tick off my bucket list and see a lot of my 80s favorite artists, including Berlin. Your voice, it's still really great. Is that good luck, or is it good genes, or do you do something to look after your voice? Because, yeah, I mean, Tony Hadley, who I think you've toured with in the US in the festival circuit, yeah. He's still got a great voice, but I know he likes to partake in a glass of wine or two. But yourself, do you look after your voice, or are you just blessed with good genes?
Health is everything. You know, I can't party like I used to. It's just, I'm not 20 anymore, and it's not going to work, you know. And I'm a mom too. I've got an 18-year-old now still in the house, and I want to be, you know, I want to be healthy. I want to be able to sing. I want to be able to, I mean, I remember when I quit smoking, it was because I was doing a song and I could not hit the high notes. And I thought, okay, this is the crossroads right here. I'm either going to be a smoker or I'm going to be a singer. And I have to choose now, because time waits for no man, and smoking is, it's not an old people's habit. It's not pretty. It doesn't work. So that I quit smoking. It was one of the hardest things I've ever done in my life, but I'm still happy about it. But yeah, I mean, it helped, just health stuff, you know, working out, I'm vegan because it makes me feel great when I eat like that. I have a wonderful sex life with my man, and I love my relationship with him. I think happiness is a big part of being healthy. You know, it's up to us to find our happiness and stay in that, because being happy is good for everybody.
Mm-hmm. No, great. That's a good point. Absolutely. We need that in our lives to make us happy.
Yeah.
Especially with everything happening around the world at the moment and things like that. And that's a really good point at the moment.
And I sure am happy now to be out of my cage, you know. I mean,
aren't you glad you met us? Come on, we got you out.
Dude,
come on.
Live shows are another animal now. People are like freaking out. It's like we're the Beatles. It's because they're just so, I know Berlin is good, but it's just being in a cage for 2 years, you know, people come out, it's like, wah! You know, they're just so happy to be drinking and partying and having fun and loving music and being with other people and dancing together. It just feels great. And I love this time of doing live shows because of that. There's a new kind of appreciation that nothing else would have given us of a live show, as COVID did.
There's a difference between listening to music in your home and singing to it, and the live music experience of being in front of Terri Nunn and Berlin and singing along, and that just that live music eclexia is just something that takes you to a different place. So that's 100% true.
There's no better drug in the world.
Yeah, 100%. I'm 100% fan. I did want to ask you about the US Festival 1983, which I believe you were a part of. That's gone down as one of the most iconic events in New Wave, and I believe you were at that event. Other New Wave acts, including Divinals, In Excess, Wall of Voodoo, Boingo Boingo, Missing Persons, The English Beat, Flock of Seagulls, Stray Cats, Men at Work, and The Clash. Do you have any recollection of that event, and what was it like?
The day that we were on was not that day. I thought that it made more sense for us to be on that day, but I really loved the day we got to be on, which was David Bowie, The Pretenders, U2, Stevie Nicks, Joe Walsh, Missing Persons, Van Zant from Bruce Springsteen's band was there. Quarter Flash was also on that one. It was just a really kind of more rock, not hard rock, but just a more rock day. And I loved it. It was one of the greatest days of my life because I got to not only play in front of 250,000 people. I mean, you literally couldn't see the end of that. The people went over the horizon of what I could see.
Can I ask you, how do you control that? When you see all those people in front of you, how does it make you feel, and how do you control your nerves and you have to sing and you have to deliver?
I just let out the happiness that I was feeling because there was nothing else to do with it. I knew that day would be one of the greatest days of my life. No matter what kind of success or not success I ever had after that, that was going to be a day that would never happen again. You know, with those people in that place, meeting Steve Wozniak, who funded that whole thing, and he lost $9 million doing it, and he didn't care. He said, I want this. This is my party. I want this to be a party, and I want to make this. And it just, it was impossible, but he did it. And it was like Cruel World. We just did a festival here called Cruel World, which was a combination of new wave and gothic music. So there was Bauhaus, and there was Berlin, and there was Devo, and there was Blondie, and there was, it was just like many, you know, Christian Death, and just and having all of these new wavers and goth, you know, chicks and guys, and all together and happy, and it was 20,000 people for 2 days, 20,000 to 40 total. And I knew this will never happen again. This is really special to have these bands and these people together. It's a gift.
Very much so.
And I feel that way about this Australian tour, because I have not gotten to play there very often. It's one of my favorite places in the world. So, you know, I don't know if this is going to happen again, but I can tell you that I'm very excited about getting to do it.
Oh, we're happy to see you. Sandra's actually seen you live. I haven't, so I'm looking forward to seeing you in January when you come to Melbourne. I'm really looking forward to that.
Sandra, where did you see us?
I saw you in the Totally 80s tour in 2016. That you were.
Oh, nice.
That you headlined.
Well, this show will be a bit longer.
I'm looking forward to it. Well, the highlight for me that night, to be honest with you, was when you dragged on stage. I wasn't aware. You dragged on stage Alan Johnston from Real Life to play bass on Dancing in Berlin, because Dancing in Berlin is probably my favorite Berlin song. And so that it has such an energy when you play it live. So I hope that's part of the set list when you come to Australia this time.
Yep.
And I'm hoping that, that we can get
Sandra's a Sandra's going to be the lead guitarist going on stage.
Yeah? All right. Yes, I will. I will make sure that that happens. It's also a very visual show. I think you'll enjoy that part of it too.
And correct me if I'm wrong, Terri, but Dancing in Berlin and No More Words and Take My Breath Away are the three songs that Giorgio worked on you with. Is that correct?
He worked on No More Words and, yeah, Take My Breath Away and Dancing in Berlin. Yes. He produced Dancing in Berlin and No More Words, yes. Yeah.
So serendipity. Speaking of your song catalogue, I'm always curious to find out from artists, are there different songs that work in different parts of the world that don't work in other parts of the world, if you understand what I'm asking?
Good question.
Yes. Yeah, some countries, they just don't get some songs that we think, well, but they're hits at home. Why don't you like them?
So do you often have, yeah, so you do find yourself tailoring the set list from time to time?
Absolutely. I tailor the set list every show we do, because it's a different audience. It's a different situation. Sometimes they want a shorter set. Sometimes they want a longer set. You know, it depends. It can be, there's so many variables to a show and where we're playing and what kind of audience it is.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah. So the other interesting thing, and I know you've been asked about this many, many times, but I believe we almost didn't have you in the sense that you would have, you were almost Princess Leia in Star Wars. So what was the tipping point for you to focus your career on music rather than all your energy into acting?
The tipping point for me when the rubber hit the road really was a show called Dallas. I, for some reason, the casting director knew me already, mm-hmm. and the producers decided that they just wanted me and I didn't have to audition for it. So they said, well, here's a 7-year contract and this is a new series. And it was the part that Charlene Tilton eventually played.
Oh, Sue Ellen's sister.
Yeah. And so, yeah, they were like, you got to sign this contract. You got to do 7 years here. And I was 18. And I thought, if I do that, this music thing that I want to try is less likely to happen. So I went home and my mom said, you know what, Terri, I think if you don't try, you will regret it. So you should try this music thing. So I told my agent that I didn't want to sign a contract and they dropped me. Wow. They thought I was out of my mind. And they were right, because for an agent, you know, what better job can you get an actor, but a series that's, you know, possibly going to be big, and it was big. Mm. You know, ridiculous money. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, my manager dropped me too. So I had nothing. I was alone. So I was like, well, I might as well try it now. I don't even have a job. So I gave myself a year to get something going on. And a year later, I met John Crawford.
And this is when you were 18.
What happened when you were 18 here, Terri? There's a lot that happened within 18.
A lot, man.
Wow, that's incredible. That's incredible. I really enjoyed reading some of the song facts about Berlin's most iconic hits, which David Diamond has posted on your social media. And one of them that I think you commented on recently was a video of you talking to Molly Meldrum from Countdown. And I think that was the first time you may have toured Australia. Correct me if I'm wrong, circa 1984, 85.
Yeah.
And that what intrigued me was to understand that when you recorded the song Sexima, you weren't expecting to get any radio airplay other than to get it airplayed on the iconic LA radio station, K-Rock.
Right.
Now, you guys are at the time obviously pretty brave and courageous. What was the thinking at the time? Was the record company behind you, supporting you? Was it to create some controversy? Because this is 1982, and that's, you know, the lyrics really still stick out in 2022.
Yeah, we didn't have a record label. Our only shot of getting played on any station was K-Rock, because we were already weird. We were an electronic band, and that wasn't going on at all. So the bigger stations wouldn't touch what we were doing with Berlin. So this little station called K-Rock was, you know, gaining momentum, and it was playing the stuff that you love, you know, that you showcase on your show. It was playing that stuff. So we thought, all right, well, we've got to come up with something that they liked, either quirky or sexy. So we're like, all right. So John came up with the groove, which was basically Donna Summer's I Feel Love, the bass line inverted. So the bass line for I Feel Love is da 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 da. No.
That's
No, I'm sorry, that's ours. Hers was da 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 da. So good. So we just did it. We inverted it. Da 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 da. So it went up instead of down. So we got that going. And then I was in a relationship at the time with this guy, and we were kind of not sexually very exciting. So I said, you know, maybe we could try some stuff. You know, we could have some fun. We could, you know, role play. And, you know, I could be a damsel in distress, and you could be, you know, a burglar, and you come in. And you take me, and he's like, Terri, I'm just a guy. I don't like that. Oh. I'm not a pirate. I'm not.
You ever seeking an actor? I'll join. Whatever you want me to be.
I'm just a guy. So I wrote the chorus. I'm a man. All he says is, I'm a man. I'm a man. I'm a man. I'm a man. And I'm like, I'm a this, I'm a that, I'm a bitch, I'm a geisha, I'm a this, you know, all the stuff that I was like trying to get him to do. So yeah, so that was the idea, and people loved it, especially women, because, you know, girls get it. We loved all that stuff.
Terri, so we've only got about 5 minutes remaining.
Okay.
So I just wanted to, is there something that no one's ever asked you that you want to put out there that you think, ooh, no one's ever really asked that? Is there anything that you'd like to put out there in public, obviously after this, but no one's ever asked you in an interview? That's a tough question.
Yeah.
So is there anything about your life that you'd like to say that no one knows about, or a song, anything at all you can share with us?
Okay. I don't think I've ever been asked, like, what if you could say, and I would love it if you asked this of your other, whoever else you're interviewing, because it's an interesting question.
It is.
If you could pick, you know, say one phrase that epitomizes your philosophy in life. Because we all have those little, you know, phrases that make sense to us about how life is, what the meaning of life. Then I would say probably that love, it was a sentence that was given to me that was so powerful that I put it on, it actually is on a plaque in my house, in my living room. Love is the whole show. And I got it on an ayahuasca trip where this being in this crazy ayahuasca world was explaining to me that everything that you see, Terri, everything, all of it is love. Everything in your world is love, all of it. Anything even that you think isn't, it is.
Love.
That is what is the engine of your world. Love is the whole show, it's all you're seeing. And I had heard that, you know, I had intellectually gotten it, God is love and all that. I'd heard it before in my life, but literally the next morning I woke up and the world was different. And it has stayed different this entire time since then. So I get it and I understand it, and it is shifted me in ways that has really helped my life.
It's moved you. Yeah.
So I think everybody has stuff like that.
Yep.
So I would love to hear that. Not only, you know, I don't know. I mean, could you say a phrase that you personally has you feel is true? Would
about
be
life,
a part
about
of
life?
Your philosophy of life?
Yeah. Well, I like peace, and you've probably heard this a million times around the world. A bit like John Lennon, peace and harmony is my biggest thing in life, my philosophy. We all should love each other because we obviously only have one life. We should live it as best we possibly can and enjoy it. There's too many other shit out there that interrupts our lives. So as long as we've got love, peace and harmony, that's my philosophy, and I don't know if Sandro has his own, but that's mine.
Yeah, look, for me, I keep going back to the, you know, the readings of, I forget how to say his name, Thich Nhat Hanh and Eckhart Tolle, and it's all, for me, it's about the impermanence of all things, so to treasure those moments, because quite often we have an expectation of continuing happiness and happiness all the time, when we realize life is a series of moments. And that's, you know, to come full circle for me, live music and seeing bands like yourself live, they're those moments that I actually treasure, because that's what they are. They are moments where, you know, you're just focused on the music, you're focused on the feeling that you get from that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, to understand that those moments come and go, and the impermanence of all things, I think that's the thing for me. That's what helps me get along in life.
Yeah.
Terri, sorry, we're about to run out of time. I don't think we've got much time left, so we're about to cut out on you, I think, I dare say. So I can see my little warning come up. Is there anything you want to say before we leave?
Thank you for including me in your show.